thank you so much for being here tonight to talk about something of utmost importance for our society, for our country, and particularly for this 40 Earth Second election, democracy. My name is Stephanie Johnson. I am one of two co-campaign managers for Joanne, who met my wonderful colleague just a little few minutes ago, Sonia Thoreau. Before we get going, I do want to acknowledge that we are on Algonquin territory. That's Esquimalt and Songhees First Nations territory. Couple of housekeeping notes. There are actually two locations for washrooms if you need to use the facilities. There is a men's washroom behind here, behind the sanctuary, and to this side, and the women's washroom behind the sanctuary and on this side, my right or left. And then there are also men's and women's washrooms behind the sanctuary on this side as well. You would just go behind these curtains that you see on either side and then make your way left, and there are people out there who can help you find the washrooms. Tonight's event is being live streamed, so if you want to go back after the evening and relive the excitement all over again, you can. But if you want to encourage others who are not sure how they're voting, where they're placing their support this election, it's a great place. It will be a great place to point them. If you could just make sure that your ringers, your cell phone ringers, are off. But we do love it if you would like to tweet. The hashtag for this evening is VoteGreen. If you don't know what a hashtag is, we'll just move on. We'll have two segments to tonight's event. The first part, we'll hear from Joanne and Elizabeth. They'll speak for about 15 minutes. And then following that, we'll have a question and answer period. And so we will look forward to having lots of discussion at that point. So, as I said, this is an incredibly important issue, this election, democracy. It is one of the core principles of the Green Party. The Green Party has six core principles. Green parties around the world have six core principles. One of them is participatory democracy. There are Greens in other countries, and we're going to hear a little bit about what Greens have brought to their democracies around the country. We're going to hear about how our democracy has been eroded, particularly over the last 9 or 10 years under Stephen Harper. We're going to hear about how MPs' jobs are to represent their constituents first. We'll hear, I'm sure, all sorts of other topics like proportional representation and what we might expect from the extraordinary Green Caucus that is going back to Ottawa with Elizabeth May on October 20th. Yeah. Here to learn about in the first half, just please ask away in the Q&A section. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about Joanne Roberts. She is our candidate in the riding of Victoria, which includes Hope Bay and a small bit of the south of Saanich as well. She is perhaps best known as the former host of All Points West on CBC Radio 1. She was the host from 2004 until 2015. I do look forward on October 20th to being able to say that that was what she was formerly best known for. She will currently be best known for being Victoria's first Green MP. She's emceeing the wedding in Ontario. She's okay. And she has a granddaughter, a new granddaughter. Her name is Georgia, and she is, Joanne is very proud of her. Joanne has 2 degrees, one in political science and one in journalism. She has co-owned a small business. She's been a union leader. She's been a university educator. And she retired from the CBC, in particular, to advocate for public broadcasting in our country and to be able to talk about what is happening to Canada and to our democracy. Then Elizabeth gave her a phone call. And her Joanne's fate was changed. We're going to learn a lot about, I suspect, from Joanne's perspective, why she needed to leave the CBC to be able to talk about democracy. So I will leave it at that, and we'll hear from Joanne, and then I will introduce the mystery woman right beside her after that.
You know, I'm a very lucky candidate. Most candidates are very grateful to have one campaign chair. I have 2 amazing campaign chairs in Stefan and Sonia. They've taken to calling themselves, along with Aldous Spurl, who I think is here, Stefonius. Because they really start to think like one person. We have a volunteer on our campaign who is a refugee from Somalia. He left Somalia when he was 8 years old because of the fighting in his country, fearing for his life. He ended up in a refugee camp in Kenya, and then in Ethiopia, and finally Egypt. 12 years after he left his home, he was accepted into Canada and has applied for permanent residency. And when he came to volunteer in our campaign, he's not yet a citizen, he can't vote. I asked him, Shamarke, we really appreciate everything you're doing for us. He knocks on doors. He is so enthusiastic about the Green Party and the campaign. But I said, Shamarke, why are you doing this? He said, I meet so many Canadians, Joanne, who don't appreciate that they can vote. He said, I left a country that when you want to change, change came with a bullet, not a ballot. And if we need anything else to remind us about the value of democracy, I think that story says it all. And every time I see Shamarke, I am reminded about what a privilege it is for me, even when I'm tired and have done 9 all-candidate debates, that this is still a privilege. I am able to talk about my vision for Canada, to talk about a vision I share with other candidates right across the country, and to encourage people to tell me whether they support that vision with their ballot, with their vote. That is a great honor. And you know, I haven't cried much on this campaign, and those of you who know that I'm a bit of a weepy type, I know I will cry when I go into the voting booth and have a chance to put an X next to my own name. I can't think that I ever in my wildest dreams thought I would have that opportunity. So democracy matters. It really, really matters. But something we forget in this country, because we're a fairly young country, is democracy also grows. I had the wonderful privilege last night to hear Margaret Macmillan speak, the wonderful historian. And she told a story about Samuel de Champlain. When Champlain came to Canada, he wrote back home about how amazing it was to see the Aboriginal people of Canada and how they were governed, that they would meet as community and vote on issues that affected the community. Champlain had never seen anybody vote before. Now think about it. You know, we take our form of voting for granted, and yet it wasn't always so. And now I think we're coming into a time, the system we have, first past the post, was designed for 2 parties. And in this country for a long time we had 2 parties. Yes, occasionally another party would show up, but it was truly the Tories and the Grits the Liberals and the Conservatives. And now we have become a multi-party country. And our voting system does not reflect the multi-party country that we have become. And we talked to a lot of young people on this campaign about why they don't vote. And the thing they say most often is it doesn't count. It doesn't matter. And I think a lot of that is first past the post. I actually believe that if we are successful in this campaign of defeating Stephen Harper and having some form of minority government that includes the Liberals, the Democrats, and Greens, the next election will be a different one. I truly believe proportional representation will change everything, to borrow a line from Naomi Klein. So I'm just very briefly, oh darn, I forgot to turn on my timer, but I'll assume that I've got about 8 or 9 minutes left. I'd like to go back in history to talk about something that in this election campaign has become so contentious, and that is what happens in minority government. Because there's a lot of discussion. If you've been at any of the All Candidates meetings, you've heard my colleagues from the New Democrats and now the former colleague from the Liberals say, you must vote for us. Because if we don't have more seats than Stephen Harper, we won't be able to stop him from forming government. But they forget our history. Our history has told us that some of the best governments in Canada have been cooperative governments. The minority governments, the ones I like, I call them the Camelot of Canada, are, 1963 and 1965, some of you have heard me talk about this before, the minority governments of Lester Pearson, hotly contested elections, and the Liberals ended up with 121 seats, and the Conservatives under John Diefenbaker, we're talking strong leaders here, under John Diefenbaker, 97 seats. And the Socreds, they kind of get forgotten in all of this, they had 24 seats. And the NDP, the fourth party, with 14 seats, but they were led by Tommy Douglas. Now, that government was not a coalition. It was a government where the parties worked together. And between the minority governments of 63 and 65, we as a country saw ourselves bring in Medicare, interest-free student loans, the Order of Canada, our Canada Pension Plan, and we adopted our flag. The Compromise Flag, not the Pearson Pennant, and not the Union Jack, but the Compromise Flag, so Canadian. And what I love about the debate over the flag, and I won't walk you all the way through it, was that 40 Conservatives, after a long filibuster, voted with the Liberals. Unheard of, but they were free to do so. They were not a heavily whipped vote in those days. And they were free to do so, and they did. In fact, two Conservatives from Quebec went to Pearson and said, invoke closure. Pearson will, or Diefenbaker will talk forever, and you'll never get this flag again, and it is time. And if you bring in closure, we'll vote with you. And we ended up with our flag. And I think if you look back at what was accomplished, as Elizabeth likes to say, you can accomplish a lot as long as you don't care who gets the credit. And right now, I think an awful lot of parties are worried about who's going to get the credit. You know, we need to get the credit for being the party that does something about climate change. We need to get the credit for being the party that does something about addressing inequality. And that is paralyzing us. You know, I got some good little bit of history about minority governments that we know more recently. And I'm sure that my friends in the New Democratic Party do not want to be reminded of the time they voted with the Conservatives in 2005 to defeat a Liberal government because they thought they could go to the polls and win a majority. Because what happened was we didn't get a majority. It was just in the middle, actually, of the Gomery Inquiry in 2005. November 28th, and it was the New Democrats who voted with the Conservatives to defeat the Liberals. We didn't require an election until 2009, but cooperation is being thrown out the window. I would say in favor of thinking they're vulnerable, let's take them now. So what did we end up with? A in 2006, our January 23rd election, going to the polls in the middle of winter, a Stephen Harper minority. Stephen Harper never really thought he should have government as a minority. He had 124 seats, the Liberals had 103, the Bloc had 51, and the NDP had 29. We did pass a law with that minority government fixing election days. But constitutionally, you can't make that stick. So in 2008, when there'd been a fair bit of talk about coalition between the Bloc and the Liberals and the NDP, Stephen Harper thought, we can't have that kind of talk going on. And the Liberals were busy shooting each other in the foot. So he thought, I might as well get them while they're weak and enough with that fixed election date. Let's go to the polls. So we have the 2008 election where Harper dissolves Parliament because he feels he's losing motions of confidence and might be forced to go to the election. He wants to be in control. And of course, that's how we ended up with the 2011 majority. So in this election campaign, when I hear Liberals and Democrats talk with great fear about minority government, I think, really? You know what possibility exists, but you also know what it takes to make minority government work. It takes a dedication to putting aside at times the party's needs, the party's agenda, and working on a Canadian agenda. And I think it is important that we're talking about democracy in this election campaign. Democracy is very important. We talk about what is common in our platforms, and because we've had so many debates, of the nine debates that we've had, the Conservative, John Mazzutti, has been at one. And that was the one today with the Chamber of Commerce. And I must admit, I've met Mr. Mazzutti. He is a fine man. But I question his interpretation of democracy. In my opinion, coming forward to meet people in a forum with your fellow candidates is essential. You do not earn votes if you're not willing, even though it can be uncomfortable, I'm sure, to be a Conservative these days in Victoria. And so I have great sympathy for him. But he knows that the record of his government is what he at least has to be able to acknowledge. But more importantly, he has to tell people what he plans to do in the future. I mean, he does say he's knocking on doors, and all of us are. It is important to meet your constituents. But in the end, we have met thousands of people at these all-candidate forums. And by not coming and not being willing to earn people's votes, I feel he has shown disrespect for democracy. And democracy. I know that when it comes to talking about power and concentration of power and what that has done to democracy, Elizabeth is the expert. She's been living it. But I will say one thing that I noticed when I was in the media, and this will be my final point. I noticed that we had an awful lot of politicians who, when they were willing to talk to us, and certainly you all know how many politicians in the government benches we were unable to talk to, but when they were willing to talk to us, it was usually because they had an eye to re-election. And I do think that because the parties have had such strict control of their MPs, and MPs, while they do, they're allowed to voice their opinions in caucus in private, but are told then how they must vote, they have too much time on their hands between elections. If you're not reading every piece of legislation, if you're not out doing research and talking to people who can make sure you're well informed on a piece of legislation, then what do you have to do as an MP? Your job is to get re-elected 4 years later. So you spend a lot of time doing good things, you know, going to public events, talking to the media when it suits your purposes. But your job then becomes getting re-elected. And then do you know what happens? You start to think about policy in 4 year cycles. And one of the things I also think is broken in democracy is we have stopped seeing leaders who are willing to look beyond the 4 year cycle, who are willing to say, Where's the big vision? Here's our vision going forward. You know, Margaret McMillan last night spoke on risk-taking. And I think sometimes politicians today, well, it is very risky to go into politics, and I admire anyone who does it, not for the faint of heart, let's put it that way. But we need to risk thinking big ideas. You know, when Tommy Douglas introduced Medicare into Saskatchewan, before it was federal, all of the doctors went on strike. And I mean, we don't mean back to work legislation, we mean on strike. No doctors in Saskatchewan to deliver babies or aid the dying. They had to bring in doctors from Britain. And I can imagine the pressure on Premier Tommy Douglas to abandon his Medicare. Instead, he met with doctors over a 2-week period, and they hammered out a compromise, and they went back to work. That's vision. That's risk-taking. That's a politician who sees the future and is prepared under our democratic system to move forward and take that risk for the good of the country. And I hope that that's what we will see in our government after October 19. I know I chose to run for the Green Party because I saw it in our leader, I saw it in our policy, and I have seen it in almost every person I've met and been in contact with in this party. Thank
you very much. I think it's quite obvious that that was both from your extensive experience and knowledge of our system, but also very much from your heart. And as someone who has worked with you closely for 9 months, I am privileged to have been able to experience that and learn from you. So thank you for sharing your thoughts with us. Now we're going to turn to Elizabeth May. Elizabeth May made history in 2011 by being elected the first Green Party Member of Parliament in Canada for the riding of Saanich Gulf Islands. In just a few short weeks, 2.5 to be exact, she will lead a raucous caucus, as she likes to call it, of Greens back to Ottawa with her. She's originally from Connecticut and moved to Nova Scotia with her family in 1973. She helped her family run a small business, a restaurant and gift shop on the Kevo Trail. She's been an activist since her earliest days, and some of the most amazing accomplishments that she has brought forward and in service to her provinces and country were very early on in her career, stopping the aerial insecticide spraying, Agent Orange, in Nova Scotia. She has a law degree from Dalhousie and was admitted to the bar in Ontario and Nova Scotia. Before she joined the Green Party, she was the executive director of the Sierra Club of Canada. And in 2006, she was elected the leader of the Green Party. Oh, there's so many things I want to tell people, but I'm going to move on. She's just a really great person. And we're very privileged to have her here tonight. So thank you, Elizabeth, for being here with us.
Thank you. Yeah, there is.
Is it
podium?
No, I just like speaking standing up, and so I'm very comfy here, and I first thank Stefan, thank Sonia, thank all the organizing team to get Joanne Roberts to Ottawa as a Member of Parliament for Victoria. I'm very grateful to all of you. So they gave me a little crib note for what I was supposed to cover with the question, why Parliament is broken? Which we could also ask them. Some of you may have seen my last book, Who We Are, where I describe the state of Canadian democracy with reference to the Monty Python skit. I don't know how many of you are Monty Python fans, but you may remember the dead parrot. It's not dead, it's merely nailed to a silver perch. Oh, it's not dead, it's nailed, no, it's nailed to a silver perch. It's a dead parrot. Well, democracy is very nearly the dead parrot. One of my favorite journalists, Jim Travers, who was the editor and publisher of the Ottawa Citizen for many years, very revered journalist, print journalist in Canada. And when my second to last book came out, called Losing Confidence, and we were both on Sunday edition with Michael Enright, it was a really telling moment because Joanne knows how CBC does things, right? So Michael Enright, of course, had to go first to Jim Travers. Well, no, that's not right, I got it wrong. He went first to me, and he said, Elizabeth, your book title is Losing Confidence, The Crisis in Canadian Democracy. Tell us why you think it's a crisis. So I went through the reasons. Falling voter turnout, abuse of power by the Prime Minister's office, slavish following of whipped votes and leaders telling MPs what to do and when to do it, and a loss of parliamentary function. I described it as it stood when my book came out, which was 2009. And then Michael Enright turned to Jim Travers and said, well, Jim, is she exaggerating? Is there a crisis in Canadian democracy? And Jim Travers said, oh, I think she's really understating it. He said, if you go to Ottawa these days, what you'll find is basically a democracy theme park. All the buildings are there. You can go visit them. You can take a tour of Parliament, but you won't find democracy. That was pretty hard-hitting. And things got worse between when I wrote that book, Losing Confidence, and when I wrote Who We Are, that came out last year. How did they get worse, and what's the source of the problem? For this, I turned to a renowned academic and expert in Canadian democracy and our parliamentary institutions. He's Professor Emeritus from the University of Toronto, and his name is Peter Russell. And what he has said in his book, which is, by the way, if you want to read up on this stuff, Peter Russell's little tiny volume, it's great. It's called Two Cheers for Minority Government. It's something every Canadian should read between now and October 19th. But anyway, Peter Russell said, the threat to Canadian democracy is increasingly well-funded and powerful political parties. That's why I call a speaking tour I did during our second prorogation of the cross-country speaking tour with the subtitle, Rescuing Democracy from Politics. The threat to democracy comes directly from well-organized, well-financed political parties. So, let's go back to square one. What's in our Constitution? What does Westminster parliamentary democracy look like? Under our Constitution, all members of Parliament are equal. And the only job description of a member of Parliament in any legislation is what you find in our Constitution, which says members of Parliament represent their constituencies. That's all it says. Why doesn't it say members of Parliament must obey every whim of increasingly whimsical, unpredictable, reckless federal party leaders? They must do what they're told. The reason there's no such reference in the Constitution is that political parties aren't mentioned at all, so certain leaders of political parties are not mentioned in our Constitution. How did we get to this place? Well, in the early days, political parties didn't have any real sway in Parliament. One of my favorite quotes from our first Prime Minister, Sir John A. Macdonald, is he referred to the members of his own party who served with him in Parliament as, quote-unquote, loose fish. They weren't swimming where he wanted them to go, and they sure weren't nailed down. Now, in this context, it's not a dead parrot nailed to its little perch. It's a fish, good and nailed down and not going anywhere. There are no loose fish around, not in the NDP, the Conservatives, or the Liberal Party, anyway. So how did democracy get so challenged by the growth of political parties? They've put their own organizing, which are basically not laws, right? They're organized as separate societies, right? Just the way any organization of under the Societies Act is organized. So the decision of how does leader of a party get elected, well, that is also not a law of Canada. That's the law of the Conservative Party, the internal laws of the NDP, the internal laws of the Green Party. So as the parties got more and more power, which they started doing first in 1963, bigger parties always make good laws for themselves. It's a trend. In 1963, they decided all of us bigger parties should get more money from the public purse because it's so hard staying on top of all the issues. So big parties, over 12 MPs, should automatically get money from the public for running our operations on our own hill. And then on top of that, over time, with no rules changing, they decided to say, and by the way, if you don't have 12 MPs, this is just by tradition and practice, no rules were changing. If you don't have 12 MPs, you can't sit on committees, and you have no automatic right to speak in question period. Strange, because all MPs are still equal. The next big change was 1970. Up until 1970, the ballot, when you went to vote, showed the names of the candidates, but didn't mention their political party affiliation. Well, that was a big change in 1970. Put the name of the political party next to the name of the candidate. And then they decided, well, we better know that this candidate really is approved by this party. So how do we do that? They decided, we'll get the leader of the party to sign the nomination papers for every candidate, then we'll be sure. It worked. I really do think that this is under the law of unintended consequences. That they created a huge stick with which a leader of a party can both threaten and punish an MP who doesn't do what they're told. Because suddenly the leader of a party, for the first time, had a plausible threat to use. If you don't do what I say, I won't sign your nomination papers. I'll throw you out of caucus. I'll throw you into oblivion politically, and you will never recover. Well, there are also other punishments that leaders of parties use, but that's the big step. Since that time, we've seen a steady growth in the power of political parties, but we've also seen a steady growth in the power of something else. Something else not mentioned in our Constitution. The Prime Minister's Office. The PMO is all it's called these days, and everyone knows what it means. And you would swear, if you landed on Canada from another planet, you'd think, oh, this PMO thing must be exactly like the White House is in the United States. It's a very, very powerful agency. It's not mentioned in the Constitution because it shouldn't exist at all. And up until Pierre Trudeau, it didn't exist. Lester B. Pearson, we've talked about Lester B. Pearson's wonderful minority parliament and the cooperation with Tommy Douglas and Lester B. Pearson. Lester B. Pearson's office was described by his principal secretary as a handful of file clerks and stenographers. It was not what it is today, a $10 million a year operation of extremely effective spin doctors and enforcers. So how does this threaten democracy? What's changed? There's been a steady trend since 1970 that every prime minister who takes office looks at the powers left behind by the previous prime minister, consolidates them, and expands them. Rather than go into the details, very premonition, let's just say what happened in 2006 under Stephen Harper. And I'll quibble only slightly with Joanne's historical review. When the NDP, the Conservatives, and the Bloc Québécois brought down the Paul Martin government on November 28, 2005, the NDP did not have in their sights winning government. They merely had in their sights destroying the Liberal Party, so that eventually, after a couple of elections, they might win government. So, that was one of the turning points for me in deciding to get involved in partisan politics. But what's happened under Stephen Harper with the majority has been truly shocking. The thing that holds Westminster parliamentary democracy together, since it's not constitutionally enshrined that a prime minister's office has this kind of power, but the parliament has that kind of power, we're not, in other words, living under a constitution like that in the United States, which was written by a bunch of people who, let's face it, didn't like arbitrary abuse of power. They got mad south of the border at King George III. They thought, guy's off his head, and we don't accept taxation without representation. Our side of the border, we thought, guy's off his head, but the next king won't be so bad. So we didn't have a revolution here. We continued to abide by the fundamental principles of Westminster parliamentary democracy. It means we're vulnerable to someone who's ruthless. We have a system of government. government without checks and balances and no protections against the ruthless. Why did Paul Martin, knowing that the execution date for his government loomed before him, his executioners announced their plan in advance? The conservatives, the NDP, and the Bloc said very publicly about 2 weeks before, some people remember this, it's funny how quickly we forget things, but I remember really clearly because November 28, 2005 was the opening day of the climate negotiations in Montreal, and I was absorbed, obsessed, and working on climate. So the idea that the government fight might fall, the opening day of the negotiations, had me, to put it mildly, freaked out. So they announced it ahead of time. We are going to bring down your government, Mr. Martin, on November 28, 2005, unless, you may remember the condition, unless you agree yourself to bring down your own government in January. Why didn't Paul Martin Perot close down the House of Commons? He knew he had a vote he was going to lose. Going to lose that vote for sure. The answer is, it simply would never have occurred to him, because it simply wasn't done. Was it legal for Stephen Harper to shut down Parliament because he saw a vote he was going to lose in the fall of 2008? Sure, it was legal. Nobody had imagined passing a law to make it illegal, because it was something no one would have ever imagined a prime minister would do. When I was researching my book, Losing Confidence, I looked in Commonwealth countries all around the world to see, did any Westminster parliamentary democracy, how many times has a prime minister shut down Parliament to avoid a vote they knew they were going to lose, and where has it happened in other Westminster parliamentary, and the Commonwealth is a fairly large chunk of countries. Turned out the only time it had happened before was in Canada, under Sir Johnny MacDonald, in the Pacific scandal. And when the House resumed after prorogation, he immediately resigned and the country went to an election. Now, I did find one example of a prime minister in Sri Lanka. Went to the Governor General to get the House shut down to avoid a vote he was going to lose, and the Governor General said no. Prorogation is an enormous abuse of power. And we've had it happen, well, it's happened 3 times under Stephen Harper, but 2 of those times have been illegitimate. What's happened with whipped votes? Well, I worked for a period of time in the 1980s in the office of the Minister of Environment in the Mulroney years. I wasn't a Mulroney fan. At the time, I kept thinking we should be doing so much more for the environment. In hindsight, it's become a sort of environmental Valhalla of achievement, but at the time, I was frustrated. But we had very few whipped votes. We did a lot of cross-party cooperation. As a matter of fact, I was in charge of the negotiations to create Guayacanas National Park. And every few days, my boss, Tom McMillan, would turn to me and say, Elizabeth, what does Jim Fulton think? Jim Fulton. I hope a lot of you remember Jim. He was the Member of Parliament for the NDP for Skeena Buckley Valley and the NDP Environment Critic. And Tom would say, does Jim know what we're doing? Does he approve of this plan? Does he think it'll work? Because he'll have called me, it's okay. And he'd say to me, have you called Charles Katchen? Charles Katchen is a Liberal Environment Critic. Is he okay with what we're doing? And Tom would say, have you talked to Buddy Richardson, Council of Climate Nation? Does he think we're okay? It was very collaborative, very open. We wanted to make it work, so we worked together. That doesn't happen anymore. And as far as whipped votes, there every single vote is whipped. Closure. Joanne mentioned using closure on the flag. You know how rare it was to invoke closure? I went and looked when I first got elected. In the first 7 months that I was in Parliament, there were 40 moves to close down debate. So I went back and looked, and I found that over a period of, wait, no, I got that wrong. The first 7 months I was in Parliament, I went back and looked because we had had 14 prorogations at that point. And I found that over a period of 45 years, there had been 7. By the time we adjourned in June, closure of debate had been used 100 times. Almost every debate on every bill had closure. I thought things couldn't get much worse. Then they have whipped votes in parliamentary committees, which used to be extremely nonpartisan. Whipped votes in parliamentary committees is at a refusal to accept amendments to bills. On a bill like Bill C-38, which was 440 pages long, the omnibus budget bill that destroyed the Fisheries Act, the Environmental Assessment Act, you probably remember it. But from first reading to royal assent, The Conservatives did not accept a single amendment, even to correct drafting errors. Every amendment became a political war that Stephen Harper refused to lose. Lastly, during this election campaign, something else that no prime minister had ever dared to do: gag the scientists, shut down the research, fire Statistics Canada, get rid of the long-form census. I heard the other day from someone, and I believe this to be true, although he told me as a senior federal civil servant about to retire, he said, "You'll never find a piece of paper that says this, you'll never find an email that says this." But when Stephen Harper got rid of the long-form census, Statistics Canada civil servants were told, "The job of Statistics Canada is to make sure there are no statistics that contradict government policy." I believe it. So they reached across the divide between the Prime Minister's political office and the Civil Service Privy Council office, a wall that's not supposed to be breached, to demand that the civil service produce the evidence they want by cooking the books. The last thing, this came out after the writ dropped, and I find it so shocking, I can't believe how our news media doesn't cover this. Elizabeth Thompson from iPolitics did the research. She went through, believe it or not, 22,000 orders in council. An order in council is a record of a cabinet-level decision. She started noticing an anomaly, because all orders in council are listed on the government website. And even if the text of the order in council isn't included, if it's suppressed as secret, there's a note: this one isn't being published for such and such reason. And maybe she was looking at Order Council 334, and then realized the next one was 336, and thought, I wonder if there was a 335, or if they skipped a number, or what's going on. To make a long story short, her research confirms that under Stephen Harper, there have been an alarming number of decisions that bind the government of Canada with no record kept where the public can find the existence of the decision, much less its content. This is particularly chilling when you realize one of the things I think they did where the Order of Council is hidden is taking land out of Cape Breton Highlands National Park to give it to a Toronto businessman to build a monstrous statue to honor Eroded. Taking land out of a national park, not publicly released. Worse, I think this is another hidden one, is a treaty with Ukraine. I've been trying to get a copy of it, I didn't access the information request, I had a leak from someone within government that Canada had actually executed a treaty with another sovereign state that Canadian parliamentarians weren't supposed to know about. It's not one of the ones that's listed. It doesn't take much to get Canada bound by a treaty through the most arbitrary means. Because guess what? Treaty powers exist in Canada under royal prerogative. So the Prime Minister with Privy Council, without the use of Parliament or a vote, can exercise royal prerogative. That's how they ratified the Canada-China Investment Treaty. Royal prerogative. And we happen to know that now the Order of Council doesn't even have to represent a decision or a vote by Cabinet. According to Elizabeth Thompson, they just walk the piece of paper around, and when four ministers have signed it, Bob's your uncle. You've ratified a treaty. Now, the fact is right now, which is egregious, despite the fact that they are only, in theory, a caretaker government, they are actively negotiating the Trans-Pacific Partnership as we speak. They can't ratify it during lunch. I don't think they dare. But they can conclude the negotiations. And then we'll find out if the Trans-Pacific Partnership coming back to Parliament can be stopped. We need real democracy in Canada. The only party that understands all of these multiple threats and understands we have to take the Prime Minister's office apart brick by brick is the Green Party. We want to cut the Prime Minister's office. We have to cut the PMO budget at least in half. I see that as a good start. We have to now pass legislation that says you can't prorogue without a three-quarters vote in the House of Commons. You can't shut down the science. You can't fire scientists. You can't suppress scientific information. Every MP has to be free to to vote in the interest of their constituents. No more widows. So, in the interest of democracy, we need a whole lot of citizens who are prepared to fight for these issues. Now, during this election, and after the election is over, we're going to have to push in a very happily minority parliament our colleagues in the other parties to be prepared to fix the democratic deficit while we fix all the other deficits and disasters that lay strewn in the wake of the great destructor himself, Stephen Harper. We have to fix everything he broke, and I can't wait to get started. Thank you so much.
The timing of the publication of this book was completely
completely unexpected for him. It made his book quite a sensation. It came out within weeks of the 2008 financial disaster. So what I want to say about tweaking the numbers or manipulating the numbers, there's no question that Stephen Harper's administration has created a false, fake surplus for last year. They have definitely played around with government spending and done things that actually increased the risk of a recession. They announced a few weeks ago in the midst of the election that we now had, oh surprise, last year, ending in the spring of 2015, it wasn't. We weren't in deficit after all, because there was $8.7 billion that wasn't spent. Well, Kevin Page is no fool, our former parliamentary budget officer, and he said, which was obvious, obviously what happened is Stephen Harper told his departments, certain departments, not all, to put the brakes on spending. So this is money that was budgeted that was supposed to be spent. $8.7 billion is a lot of money not to spend. Where did they decide to put on the brakes? Well, that's right. First Nations communities were one place that lost money that was supposed to be spent in the budget. Municipal infrastructure, public transit, another place where they put on the brakes. Another place, processing refugee claims. Another place, Veterans Affairs. So they created a fake surplus last year. This year they created a fake surplus by postponing our budget till April 21st so they could book the sale of the GM shares into 2015-2016. So it's a lot of fakery going on there. In terms of recession or not recession, the reality is our economy's been stagnant for the last 3 years. So while we talk about a steady state economy, it doesn't look like the stagnant economy in the last 3 years, because in a healthy steady state economy, you move to full employment. So things are humming along as opposed to petering out. You need to have a very different kind of economy to meet Peter Victor's standards of managing without growth. So the reality of it is, they may or may not have filled those numbers. I tend to think they didn't, because they'd be caught out very quickly by the people they worry about, the money guys. They don't worry about fisheries biologists. They worry about the money guys in the bank saying, wait a minute, we think, because they've got their own independent money, I mean their own independent numbers. Chances are we're still in marginally a recession. The funniest part, I shouldn't go on with this, but the funniest part is listening to Stephen Harper say, well, it's only the energy sector that's in decline. These other sectors, manufacturing, pulp and paper, tourism, oh, they're doing better. Those are the very sectors Stephen Harper has ignored for 9 years while he put all of his economic development plans in the oil sands. So that's a too long answer to it.
Well, just one thing on stats, Canberra, because you asked, and that is, you know, the long-form census was replaced with a national household survey. And it cost $22 million to put out that survey. You need a 75% return rate for it to be statistically significant. We only reached 69%. So in order to save all that money by not having a long-form census, we spent $22 million for useless information.
Thank you.
We're going to go to a question. I believe there's someone in the back who had their hand up.
It was me.
Oh.
It was me.
Okay, we'll just go to you.
Thank you,
sir.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Rory Delaney. Elizabeth, I agree with everything you said. And I've watched you fight to have a say in a parliament that lacked that. You know, which is terrible. But we, the people, we, all of us, stood by for 10 years and watched all this happen. What can we do? What can you do to stop us from being so complacent?
Rory, thank you. Actually, I can't bring it. It's not in my heart to blame Canadians for this. In short, I blame the Canadian media. Our journalistic core has ignored this as it happened. I've gone into editorial board meetings, a number of them, where I talk about what's happening to Canadian democracy, and I've had journalists, really respected journalists, names you would know, say, do you think Canadians care about this stuff?
Yeah.
That's exactly what they say word for word, and in that tone of voice, in different operations of the Canadian Council, well, they would if you told them. If it was news coverage, they said, well, Privy Council Office, having the Prime Minister breach the firewall of the Privy Council Office, orders of council that are secret, you think Canadians care about this? Yes. Do I think they care about democracy? Yes, I think we care about democracy. So one piece of a healthy democracy that we're missing right now is competition and diversified ownership in our news media. We have 42 daily newspapers owned by Post Media. Now it's true that Globe and Mail is no longer has any ownership interests from CTV, but the Globe and Mail is owned by a corporation. But there are very few independent voices anymore within the news media, and so I think that's a big part of the problem. What we can do, and you're going to have to see if I follow up, but what we can do as citizens is share this information as much as possible, is write letters to the editor. I want to know of all the candidates in this election. I want to know from the leaders in this election. What will they do to restore parliamentary democracy and reduce the power of the Prime Minister's office? I think it's a key question to push Tom Mulcair on and to push Justin Trudeau. We know where Stephen Harper is on it. But you know, it's I had hoped to, I should mention this now so I don't forget later. One of the, we talked about the debates and not having the conservative local candidates show up. It's essential that we somehow convince, although we just heard yesterday that he won't change his mind, we convince Tom Mulcair to show up, because the national televised leaders debates broadcast by CBC, CTV, and Global are probably 24 hours away from being canceled, because neither Stephen Harper nor Tom Mulcair will come. And that's a really key opportunity to engage Canadians across the country in what it means to have a healthy democracy where parliamentarians respect our traditions and recognize the fundamental principle of supremacy of parliament, that the Prime Minister reports to parliament and not the other way around. The way it's going now, the Prime Minister's office is controlling absolutely every decision by the bureaucracy and by the politics and by the governance structures of our country. The only thing Stephen Harper hasn't managed to wreck yet is the Supreme Court of Canada, but he's working on it.
Thank you. My fear is that Stephen Harper has shown how it's done. And
yes.
Let me think, there are lots of people who would love to duplicate what he has done.
Right. Oh, and I was just going to add briefly to what Elizabeth said, but you're absolutely right. Stephen Harper, for example, was the person who said, I'm not going to a debate. And then Tom Mulcair said, well, if he's not going, I'm not going. And, you know, I've got to give credit to the woman who walked into our office the other day. She said, I've never voted green before. I'm voting green because Tom Mulcair won't go to the debate and there have to be consequences. And, you know, what can Canadians do? There have to be. Just in case this doesn't come up, one of the reasons we are seeing a diminishment of our media in Canada is we're a small population. And our one sort of defense about seeing our media become controlled by their corporate masters was our national broadcaster. And I know I have a vested interest in this, but I have worked in public broadcasting and private broadcasting pretty much all of my life. And I can tell you, and my colleagues in private radio, television, and print will tell you the same thing. If the national broadcaster is setting the bar here, the privates have to set the bar here. When the national broadcaster brings the bar down here, that's exactly what happens with everyone else. You've heard the stories of how hard it is in this media environment to make money. You don't spend money on your newsroom if you don't have to. That has always been the case. And we have one CBC reporter for all of Vancouver Island. One. Now you tell me that that's putting pressure on other newsrooms around this province. It's not. And there's a real, I know that Stephen Harper ideologically doesn't like a public broadcaster, but he has destroyed it for a very specific purpose. Yeah.
Good evening. Hi, my name is Greg Meeklejohn, and I think you're going to win, by the way. So what I heard tonight is basically the theme it is government bad, maybe corrupt bad. And so, but what I'd like to know is specifically, I'm curious, I can hear you learn about the future. And what I'd like to hear from Elizabeth in particular, Cindy and I, is